certain white shades. And as they say, then when there are different types of shades, the profession is good for the lawyers. But be that as it may, one of the issue as to whether there is an interplay with if once he's a government servant, or rather the definition of the servant itself has changed the dynamics of, they say, as just like constitution, as they say, it's a living organization, a living institution that keeps on changing with the flux of time. What may not be good for in the earlier era is good today, and what may be good today may not be good for tomorrow. The classic example is section 377 of the IPC, where we discuss initially homosexuality was a taboo, but with the flux of time, there is a stamp that is valid and so and so. And since we had brought Mr. P.S. Rajagopal, the senior advocate from Karnataka High Court, on the previous webinar, a lot of his followers, I would say, called me up. They say that one of his forte is under the Prevention of Corruption Act. Normally, a lawyer creates his niche either in the civil side, constitutional side, or a criminal side. But a lawyer who can actually keep the juxtaposition of both the two subjects and is at ease, as they say, like earlier at point of time, I give sometimes a lot of semblance from the cricket, that there was a left-hander or a right-hander. But nowadays, whatever back side you play, but you are dexterous to play for the both sides. So same way, I can say that Mr. P.S. Rajagopal is also a dexterous player who can give the insights of the different perspectives, and that too in an interplay. So we may not be playing cricket, but yes, I can say that the words, the way he expresses and the judgments which he flows automatically is as easy as they say that the shot was as good as the song. And same are his way of presentation. Without taking much time, since I understand that it's a weekend, the lawyers sometimes want to enjoy, and at the same time, some people want to sit in the office. Without taking much time, I would request Mr. P.S. Rajagopal, who has agreed to come again on our platform to share his knowledge. It's always a pleasure connecting with him off the platform and on the platform. Over to you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Vikas. I must say at the outset, Vikas is never tired of praising me. I am really not that dexterous. Friends and fellow law workers, the topic that has been chosen for the present day discussion is very important, in as much as if there is one offense under the Prevention of Corruption Act where satisfactorily accounting your assets would depend on your adherence to the service rules, it is the offense of possessing disproportionate assets beyond the known sources of disproportionate to known sources of income. The offense does not stop there. Next phrase is very important. Which the public servant is unable to satisfactorily account for. Possessing assets is not an offense. Possessing assets which you cannot satisfactorily account for is an offense. Before going to the offense specific, let me tell something about the strange coincidence. We became free country in the year 1947. And Prevention of Corruption Act is also of 1947. Are we suggesting that we became corrupt only on attaining independence? No. Even under the foreign rule, we had sections 161 to 165 capital A of the IPC. But possessing assets disproportionate was not a specific offense. Even then, it was not uncommon that public servants were found to be in possession of disproportionate assets. And though it was not a substantive offense, either under the IPC or even under the Prevention of Corruption Act, which we enacted in the year 1947, there is case law about disproportionate assets, even before it became a specific offense. It was for the reason that the IPC, as also the Prevention of Corruption Act that was originally enacted, spoke of offenses such as habitually accepting illegal gratification, habitually accepting the gifts, habitually purchasing materials for a inadequate price. There were 3 or 4 offenses like this. The problem was with the word habitual. Yes, if it is a case of one demand for a bribe, you can lay a trap and book him. How do you prove this habitual bribe taking or habitual acceptance of gifts? Then the courts were invoking the concept of known sources of income. They would say, this is your known source of income. Your total assets are this. Therefore, you must have received habitual illegal gratification, habitual gifts, habitual purchase of goods at a concessional price, which itself is a gratification. Therefore, this is one offense of possession of disproportionate assets, which became an offense even before it formally entered the statute book. Because the general principle is that in criminal law, offense should be strictly defined and strictly construed. But here is one offense which was used, though not to substantially punish a person for this particular offense, to punish him for the habitual bribe taking or habitual gift taking by using the standard of known sources of income and total assets. For the first time, the possession of disproportionate assets became an offense in the year 1964, to be precise, on 8th December 1964, by enactment of anti-corruption amendment laws, which brought about certain amendments to the Prevention of Corruption Act. Particularly, it introduced Section 5(1), Clause E, which defined the offense as the possession of assets disproportionate to known sources of income. And one thing is, please remember, prosecution for this charge can be initiated even after retirement, because the phrase used is, if he is in possession or was in possession anytime during the period he was rendering his service as public servant. Therefore, this is one specific offense that came into the statute book in the year 1964. And it is not an accident that conduct rules for public servants also underwent substantial changes. The first such change being in the Central Civil Service Conduct Rules, which also came in December 1964, exactly about 8 days after insertion of Clause E to Section 5(1) of the Prevention of Corruption Act. When I am talking about interplay of this offense with the conduct rules, we will be focusing on the phrase known sources of income. What is meant by known source of income? Income can be illegitimate income also. Suppose I steal, that is not a known source of income, because the first requirement of known source of income is it should be lawful. Known source of income was originally not defined under section 51E. For the first time it came to be defined by the 1988 Act, not until then. But even when it was not defined, one thing that is clear is that known source of income means it must be a lawful source, not an unlawful source. Or to put it differently, it must be a legitimate source, not an illegitimate source. Then came how to know what is your legitimate income. For that purpose, conduct rules made various provisions, about which I will come see in another 5 to 10 minutes. Before that, prior to 1988, under the 1947 Act, there was no definition of known source of income. At the same time, subsection 3 of section 5 of the Prevention of Corruption Act before 1964 contained a provision which said that if basic ingredients of the offense are established, then the offense is deemed to have been committed. That will have to be rebutted by the public servant in an appropriate manner. Now look at the position before 1964. The offenses that were enumerated were only habitual bribe taking, habitual taking of gifts, habitual purchase of materials or goods or valuables for insufficient consideration. But the presumption under subsection 3 of section 5 was the only tool to really prove the component of habitual offending, habitual committing of that offense. There was no requirement of any reporting of your income. There was no requirement of taking any prior permission to acquire any asset. We could resort to provision of section 106 of the Evidence Act and prove our defense, because normally case is to be proved by the prosecution. But what are the known sources of income of a public servant is a matter which is in exclusive or special knowledge of the public servant himself. When a charge sheet is filed, to the best of their investigation, whatever sources are found to be there, those sources will be disclosed. After the prosecution case is closed, that is at the stage when presumption under subsection 3 of section 5 arises, it was open to the public servant to defend himself and rebut the presumption in law by leading his evidence as to there, look, these lawful sources I have of my income, which the prosecution has not pointed out in its case. This loophole was plugged under the 1988 Act because it introduced a provision or an explanation to the term what is known sources of income. it defined. Known sources of income means that income which the public servant has disclosed to the persons, to the authorities to whom he is required to disclose under the law, rules, or whatever rules having force of law in force. Lord Chief Justice Arijit Pasait has, in one of the cases, distinguished the position before 1988 and position after 1988 very succinctly when he said, under the prior to 1988 Act, it was open to the public servant to say, to tell the to tell the court that, look, these income, these sources of my legitimate income have been ignored. Therefore, acquit me by resort to Section 106. But after the 1988 Act came into force, the prosecution is virtually relieved of its obligation to investigate into your sources of income, because known sources of income means you must have declared it to the competent authority as required under your service rules from time to time. If you are not disclosed, it is not a source of income at all. Suppose my wife is having her own business. It is unfortunate truth that most of the civil servants' wives become business people or entrepreneurs within 1 year of public servant assuming office. I am not castigating anybody in this, but this is hard reality of our life. When people come to me with these cases, first thing they will say, sir, my wife is an independent entrepreneur. My mother-in-law is an independent entrepreneur. They are all income tax assessees. Here are the income tax assessment orders. My question to them would be, when did you enter service? You would give a date. When did your wife become an entrepreneur? He would give a date. It would invariably be subsequent to this man becoming a public servant. To plug these loopholes, various provisions have been made in the conduct rules. What are those, sir? I'll be referring to the rules with reference to Central Civil Service rules. In all other services, the serial number of the rule may be different, but substantially same, because as in most of the service rules, they are verbatim same, except that the some phraseology, like instead of government servant, it may say bank servant, or it may say servant of the BHEL or servant of the BEML. Like that, it can go on changing, or HMT, but substance is same. First requirement is, if you are acquiring any immovable property, prior permission where you are acquiring the property from a person with whom you are having official dealings of the competent authority will have to be obtained. In other cases, post facto reporting to the competent authority has to be made within 1 month. Then acquiring movables, where the value of the movable is beyond a threshold limit, it has to be reported. After these two reports of individual transactions, then comes the annual property returns, where you are required to report for the first time, once you enter the public service, you have to give a statement of your assets and liabilities, where you are required to disclose not only what you have. Suppose you have inherited some property, or let us take the case of an agriculturist family, where from the joint family agricultural operations, public servant is receiving a particular share. That also will have to be mentioned. Then suppose he holds a share in the joint family because in the joint family property, but partition has not taken place. Even that he has to state, saying that I am entitled to 1/5 share or 1/10 share or 1/20 share in my ancestral property, of which karta is so and so for the time being. I am not looking after the property, but one day I may inherit it. A very interesting case came before the Supreme Court where the plea set up in his explanation to account for the property found to be in excess of his salary income was that these are incomes from my inherited property. Supreme Court said, we cannot take it into account because the known sources of income has been defined by the Act, which says that if you have not reported, we cannot take cognizance of it. Therefore, reporting becomes very, very important. Now, what happens most of the times, at least in some organizations, there is no enforcement of discipline that even for decades together, they would not have filed the annual property returns. Like some of the top management people being remiss in writing annual performance reports. In a number of cases, we come across where annual performance reports are written once in 5 years when the public servant becomes due for promotion. That is not the thing. Annually, it has to be reported. And once you have reported, it may not give legitimacy to the source, but at least it will enable you an opportunity to say that, look, I have reported. What is reported every time, it need not be the ultimate taken as a valid defense. But if it is not reported, it is not reported, you cannot even cite that defense. Then there is another clause in the conduct rules that is about employment of family members, or the word used there is near relatives, in firms having dealings with you or dealings with the government. If it is dealings with the public servant concerned, then prior permission is required. Otherwise, if he is likely to have dealings with the government, within 30 days of your coming to know of it, you'll have to report. There, of course, a very strange phrase is used. No public servant shall permit his sons, daughters, wife, or family members from taking up employment. The word used is little anachronism, because today not many of the major children seek the parents' permission to take up an employment. Those days are gone. Even to take up a course of study, they won't ask the parents' permission. They come and say, Papa, I want to join this course. Papa will have his own ideas. A lawyer would be thinking, why not my son also become an advocate? Say, kyun beta, why are you doing this? Why don't you join LLB course? You see, the earlier it might have worked, but the law remains the same even today. No public servant shall permit his close family members from taking up employment. But the rule also recognizes sometimes children may take up employment without the knowledge of the parents. Therefore, they say that if it is not within your knowledge, the moment it comes to your knowledge, report it within 30 days of the knowledge. This advocate should be in a better position to understand why this restriction. I'm not again having any particular person in mind. We have seen the moment father becomes a judge, the son advocates practice source. This type of interplay between father's position and son's profession is sought to be brought within four corners of law by requiring the public servant to seek permission from the government where his son or daughter or wife wants to get employed with a company or an entity having official dealings with the civil servant, or reporting in the remainder of the cases, even when he is not you are not having any official dealings. Then there is another provision in the conduct rules which deals with the gifts. The rule requirement of the rule is that no public servant shall accept gifts from anybody, more so if he is having official dealings with you, or if he is likely to have official dealings with you. Then the rule also recognizes that there are religious and social practices that on certain occasions it is customary to receive the gifts. There the rule stipulates individual gift should not extend beyond this, should not be beyond a particular limit. And more importantly, it says after the function you make a report that these are the gifts received, or the total value of the gifts received, depending upon the nature of gifts that you have received. Suppose your father-in-law gives you a car, he reported it. This I have received from my father-in-law. Except when you make all these reportings, these will be presumed to be your assets. These will be presumed to be assets of the public servant, and you will fall foul of the offense of fault processing assets disproportionate to known sources of income. So one is prior permission for employment of members of the family. Second is filing annual property returns as on the date of your entry into service. Thereafter, filing annual property returns every year, including showing what is the additional and all that. In that statement, the prior permission of the government for purchase of immovable properties and reporting in other cases. Then there is one more rule regarding the reporting requirement. That is, no public servant is supposed to engage himself in any private trade or employment. It so happens that suppose there is a family business. As a public servant, I may not be involved directly in the business, but still, I am a partner in that business. Law does not prohibit you from becoming a partner in such businesses. Or suppose a closely held a family company is there. There is no restriction on the public servant from being a shareholder in that company, as long as he is not actively participating in the management of the company. But this is very important, but the fact of his family business or he being a member, a shareholder in a closely held company, these will also have to be reported, and sometimes these will have prior permission has to be obtained. Suppose it happens in a number of cases. As we grow, so many additions will be taking place to the family. Younger members of the family may say, I want to start this enterprise. Please invest this much. Fair enough, that there is nothing that prevents you from investing. But only thing is, prior permission of the government or the employer will have to be taken. Then there is another very tricky provision of reporting. I don't say tricky provision of reporting. It is a very tricky restriction. That is, when you are buying something from not very reputed or authorized dealer, prior permission is required. This comes, and this came also, this very important question came. Most of us have been witness to Harshad Mehta scam. That is security scam or whatever name you call it. When investigation started into that scam, one very interesting fact came to light. Certain officers in the Reserve Bank of India, which is supposed to be the regulator of banking industry, some officers in the finance ministry of the central government, then various state government officials, the investigation disclosed, all these people have been allotted shares of promoter quota on a priority basis in various public issues or premium issues which went into market during that particular period. Buying shares in the market through stock exchange is not prohibited. But taking promoter quota shares in a company is not through stock exchange. It is a private deal. And no public servant had taken prior permission from the employer. And when this offense was found to have been committed within the Reserve Bank itself, which lays down norms for functioning of all other banking institutions, the management recognized that it has been a usual practice. Usual practice contrary to law. Market practice not sanctified by law. They came out with a very ingenious scheme to save its employees. That they obtained legal opinion from certain retired judges of the Supreme Court. I don't want to name them. They are all honorable men. That it would not amount to a misconduct. That is, taking shares under promoter quota in a public limited company, which is definitely not through a normal channel of acquisition, was whitewashed as not being a misconduct. But every public servant would not be as lucky for all times to come. Maybe it was happening for the first time in the history of banking industry. So they found a magic wand to whitewash this sins. But sins repeated, luck would not smile repeatedly. Therefore, the requirement of obtaining permission or making a report, as the case may be, whenever you acquire something through persons who are not authorized dealers, has to be followed. This is another provision. Now, how would this affect or how it would have a bearing on offense of disproportionate assets insofar as Prevention of Corruption Act is concerned. Now, by 2018 amendment of the Prevention of Corruption Act, read with the original 88 Act, certain things we will have to take into account. One thing is, it defined for the first time the word undue advantage. Gaining undue advantage is also an offense. And multiplication of that offense would lead to the offense of possessing assets disproportionate to known sources of income. Now let us take undue advantage. It means any gratification, whatever, other than legal remuneration. That is, suppose something we have, the public servant has purchased at a subnormal price, then it is an undue advantage. Then gratification, that is also defined. Earlier, gratification means it must be in money only. Now it need not be in money. Giving employment to a public servant's son is also gratification, which cannot be, whose value cannot be assessed in money. Here, taking permission for employment in private firms, which is a requirement of the conduct rules, comes into play. Suppose permission has been obtained, it will be available for the public servant to say that, look, I have reported, obtained permission, I have not breached the conduct rules. Then there is legal remuneration that is also defined now by the 2018 amendment. Legal remuneration is not restricted to remuneration paid to a public servant, but includes all remuneration which is permitted by the government or the organization which he serves to receive. Now, under the 2018 amendment, the explanation defining known sources of income has been removed. But it is not that even without reporting, we can rely that on that as a defense to account for, because of these three insertions. What is the insertion? Undue advantage, gratification, legal remuneration. Now suppose in a joint family property, a commercial complex is constructed and public center rent is receiving 1 lakh or 2 lakhs per month as his share of rental income. If you go by legal parlance, it is a legal income. It is a lawful income. But it would not fall under the definition of legal remuneration because conduct rules require it to be reported or permission to be obtained for starting a private trade or private employment or whatever it is, or if you want to be a member of a private trade or employment. If you have breached the conduct rule, the consequence would be it would perhaps go out of the sweep of the phrase legal remuneration. Of 2018 Act has not yet been tested judicially, it has not been interpreted. But merely because the explanation under section 13(1)(e), earlier it was 5(1)(e) under the 1947 Act, under the to the 1988 Act, it became 13(1)(e). Now, after the 2018 amendment, it has become 13(1)(b). The definition of known sources of income, which was there in the 88 Act, has been taken away by the 2018 amendment. But it would be wrong to think that adherence to conduct rules, particularly in the matter of reporting or seeking prior permission, that can be wished away, because even now, the definition clauses that have been changed, that is, particularly regarding legal remuneration, that would still require adherence to the conduct rules. Now, earlier regime, there was a very constricted definition of public servant. This I am trying to bring in for the reason that the conduct rules as they exist today does not cover the entire spectrum of public servants under the Prevention of Corruption Act. For example, under the IPC regime, as Section 21 existed then, Section 21 of the IPC existed then, a railway servant was not a public servant because he was not an employee of the government. But railway servant was a public servant because railways was owned by the government. Then there was another provision. Suppose a person is holding a public office, which comes within the definition of public servant. Even then, he would not be a public servant for the purposes of Prevention of Corruption Act if there was defect in his appointment to that office. A very interesting case occurred. One magistrate appointed a court commissioner. By definition, court commissioner is a public servant for the purpose of Prevention of Corruption Act or even IPC. But the magistrate who had appointed him had no authority to do it, had no jurisdiction to do it. Ultimately, the court commissioner was let off from the charge of offense on the ground that he had no legal title to the office. No doubt, he was in possession of an office which would make him public servant. But because of the defect in holding of that office, a defect in title to that office, he was excluded. Today, under the 1988 Act, it has been clarified that he, notwithstanding any defect in his entering that office, or notwithstanding any defect in his title to the office, he would still be a public servant for the purpose of Prevention of Corruption. Otherwise, if the law was not like that, you imagine what would have happened in the present days. Members of Public Service Commission, people in Punjab would appreciate this analogy much easier than people in the rest of the country. Not that I am not saying it's because that things are better here. Things are as thinking as it is in Punjab. Only thing is Punjab reached the Supreme Court, therefore I have to refer to Punjab. Haryana Public Service Commission, Staff Selection Commission reached the Supreme Court, therefore I have to refer. A person who doesn't possess any qualification, fortunately no qualification is prescribed for that post, except that he must be mentally sound and he must be above 21 years of age. Except these two qualifications, no other qualification is mentioned. Suppose he is appointed to Public Service Commission. The person appointing him deliberately makes the appointment little flawed in the hope and firm expectation that nobody will challenge it. Then you look at it. An unqualified person holds a public office and he can be corrupt. because for the purpose of public office, he is not a, for the purpose of Prevention of Corruption Act, he is not a public servant because there is defect in his title to the office. This would have been, this was a disastrous situation. Therefore, the law was amended under the 1988 Act, which specified that notwithstanding any defect in the title. Then this definition of the word public servant was also widened. Today, anybody performing a public duty is a public servant. Now, what is the extent to which we have gone? A trustee of a private educational institution is a public servant for the purpose of Prevention of Corruption Act. He may not be a public servant for Section 21 of the IPC because he discharges public functions, public duties, he is a public servant. Then at one point of time in the celebrated case of Abdul Rahman Antule, A.R. Antule, the then Chief Minister of Maharashtra, it was held that MLA is not a public servant. Grand Municipal Councillor is not a public servant. All these have been plugged now and it is so wide. Every panchayat member is a public servant. Every councillor is a public servant. Anybody who performs public duties in which the society is interested, he is a public servant. At this rate, now it is hard, it is very difficult to find a person in public office who can be excluded from the purview of the phrase public servant. If you strictly apply the, suppose there is a private enterprise which enjoys state conferred monopoly, I think under the new definition, even the managing director of that private enterprise will become a public servant. That analogy was extended in case of Ramesh Gelli. Till Ramesh Gelli's case, we were all thinking that a managing director of a private sector bank is not a public servant. But Supreme Court held with reference to the perform the duties of that office and also Section 46F of the Banking Regulation Act that officers and chairmen of private sector banks are also public servants. Therefore, you have enlarged the scope of public servant, but there is no requirement of reporting or seeking permission in their cases for acquisition of properties. It is high time that invoking the provisions of Prevention of Corruption Act itself, certain reporting requirements have to be introduced to those public servants who are not governed by these conduct rules, which require periodical reporting and prior permissions in certain stages. Otherwise, what is happening? Now, we come across these election affidavits for the persons contesting here. Elections for MLA or MP or whatever the office. Their assets increase, multiply 5 times in 5 years. Every one of them must be having a gold mine or something like that. But there is no way to book them for disproportionate assets except the income tax returns. Because, yes, I say, is it because of my business acumen? My assets have quadrupled or multiplied by 10 times and all that. These stupid defenses, if we will have to put an end to make the society more humane, free from the dissipation of our natural and national resources, Sun conduct rule, which is akin to the one applicable for civil servants or employees of the public sector organizations, some such similar reporting system will have to be introduced. Therefore, by removal of that explanation under section 13(1)(e), things have not been made any easy for money makers from acquiring the properties. On the other hand, by introducing appropriate changes in the definition clause, that liability and that requirement of reporting and obtaining permissions continues. But once you have expanded the scope of the phrase public servant, there is a need to make similar rules by resort to rulemaking power under the Prevention of Corruption Act itself or otherwise to bring a uniform reporting and reporting system so that what is illegal accumulation of wealth today does not walk out of the trial as a legal accumulation of wealth, because ultimately the provision making it an offense to be in possession of assets disproportionate to known sources of income is an offense which will cut at the vitals of this society. If our next generation has to say that we are living in a less corrupt society than my parents lived, it is necessary to amend the requirements of reporting, bring it in compliance with what is there or the philosophy behind the conduct rules for public servants. I have taken more time than, because normally I would stop at the 50th minute, but today I think I have taken little 2 or 3 minutes more. Now I would be happy to.
So we don't have a stopwatch that you have to stop once the session is going well.
Maybe because I should not be told that I have taken time disproportionate to my allotted time. Which I can, of course, satisfactorily account.
Since you are not a public servant, you nothing will happen. So Section 13 will not be invoked in any case.
Yes, it will not be. It cannot be invoked because.
So you are not public servant. I take a cue what Raghu has said. How do you define public duty? I will say that while performing public duty, you have overreached, but within the parameters which people actually liked it.
Thank you, because
so a lot of questions have popped up.
Yes, it would be a pleasure to be answering questions.
Yeah.
This
is civil services rules require Dowry declaration certificate to be submitted. Kindly discuss this aspect and has this
declaration?
Dowry declaration, as we all say, under the, I do not know what is in Karnataka. Out here is good conduct rules 1965.
Dowry declaration.
They say that you have to declare that what items you have received in the marriage, etc. So they say that the menace has not stopped. What is your take on that?
In every conduct rules, that declaration is there. In fact, that provision is there. If you go to the central rules, rule 13 capital A specifically makes it a misconduct of giving or taking or abetting, giving or taking of dowry. But occasional gifts, as I was telling, is not prohibited. There's no doubt some of the young public servants, particularly those who are fortunate to be directly recruited to high offices, they may feel that it is cumbersome. But remember, if you want to be a public servant, your freedoms will be curtailed. And curtailment of freedoms to a reasonable extent is permissible in law. Therefore, declaration of dowry, it will be usually, because nobody can say that I have received 1 crore dowry. He would say dowry received nil. But there is no prohibition to receive gifts. He may say, after all, my daughter is being given in marriage to you. I want to give to you a house. That is not prohibited under the service rules. But after 3 years or 4 years, when divorce case comes, charge is dowry harassment. If you have made a proper declaration that dowry is zero, these are the gifts received. It may help you even to defend yourself properly in the dowry harassment case. But notwithstanding these restrictions, I agree that menace of dowry is very much prevalent. And in some of the communities, it goes to a few crores. And there is a schedule of rates. If you want doctor as your son-in-law, if your daughter is also a doctor, this is the rate. Then depending upon the specialities, there is different rate. According to me, the existing laws are not inadequate. Existing laws have adequate provisions. But the enforcement is lacking. What is that lack of enforcement? Normally, no girl would come and go and say that I have paid this much dowry, because she wants her family to be settled. More importantly, as long as there is a feeling amongst the dowry givers themselves that, look, I got such a big son-in-law, very highly qualified, highly positioned son-in-law, because I could pay this much dowry. If it is taken as a matter of pride, instead of viewing it as a matter of shame, Rule 13 capital A will not come to the rescue of menace of dowry. It has to come only by gradual change of thinking. It is an evolving process. It cannot come overnight. It is easy to say, if every person decides, I will not take dowry, I will not give dowry, it will be a dowry-free society. It can be easily said, but those resolutions still will not be majority resolutions. It will be individual resolutions. By a process of women empowerment, by a process of debate and discussion. Today, unfortunate part of this country is that there is no debate. What is the debate we are having? WhatsApp messages. There you will find remedy for every social evil and every security problem, every issue that the country is facing, you will find WhatsApp solutions. WhatsApp debate is not the debate. Debate is like what we are having. A discussion, the exchange of views. This only can erase the menace. As on today, the Rule 13 capital A, which speaks of dowry prohibition, is very much relevant, and its adherence to very much, that is very much necessary. But by going by common parlance, unless something is demanded, taken as a condition precedent for marriage, you cannot call it even as a dowry. Because today we are having, most of us are living in one child family and two child families. girl has equal right to the property. In such a situation, how do you define dowry? You can always say that I am giving a portion of her share. As long as there is no mercenary relationship in that. Mercenary means, I am saying, before I tie the knot, this much should be given. After I tie the knot, for the first Diwali, this much should be given. If such type of schedule is fixed for every event, like running account bills, then only it becomes dowry. Otherwise, it will not be called stricto sensu dowry, and it will be difficult to prove that it is a dowry. Therefore, public servants are right as long as they are saying no dowry. To be completely right, they should disclose the gifts. Yes, sir.
As you rightly said, that there's a subtle difference between the practice and a preach. You can practice. And I just read an article. It said that if one goes by the volume of candlelight march, then the society would have been free from all the ills.
Yes.
It is becoming more of a lip service rather than actually working upon that.
It is more for TV cameras. We have social service for TV cameras. All these protest actions have, like, how many of the persons who protest really believe in their cause and are willing to sacrifice their for their cause?
This is by, he has not written the name. He says, is the information which is declared to the government accessible to third party / spouse under the RTI?
See, there, section under the prohibitions under the RTI Act, personal information is privileged in the sense it need not be disclosed.
Section 8.
Parties, except where public interest outweighs, public interest in disclosure outweighs the protection of privacy. Because what are my assets? I am entitled to be kept confidential. Except that I disclose to the employer as a matter of requirement under the service rules. About the disclosure, there are two opinions now. Earlier opinion was that spouse is entitled to get it. But present opinion, even of the Central Information Commission, appears to be that it need not be disclosed, except after forming an opinion. So there are two safeguards under the RTI Act. Suppose the information concerning a public servant is asked, which is the nature of a third party information. First, opinion of that public servant on disclosure will have to be taken. He has to be put on notice that so and so has sought these particulars, which are your personal details, shall be disclosed. He may say whatever he wants to say. Then on the basis of that say and the demand for the information, the public information officer has to formulate an opinion whether public interest outweighs the requirement of privacy. Then it can be, but generally my view on this is that except under compulsion of a court order. Now I'm not saying about the information commission's order. Suppose some information is required for assisting a judicial proceedings. Let us take this way. Now wife may files an application for maintenance. In the maintenance proceedings, both parties are supposed to disclose their income. when a dispute arises as to what is the correct income figure of the one of the spouses who is the defendant, the defendant as also the plaintiff in a civil proceedings are obliged in law to disclose best evidence in their possession. If they do not disclose the best evidence in their possession, the adverse inference can be drawn under 116 of the Evidence Act. Therefore, the view can be like this, because it is a difficult question which would answer for which would depend on facts and circumstances of each case. Generally, under RTI Act, there is no license to furnish the information. But as I was telling, if public interest in disclosure far outweighs the rights of an individual, then it shall be disclosed. And one of the defenses raised by the judges of the High Court and Supreme Courts, which, because you would remember about 10 years ago, there was a cry that the assets and liabilities of judges will have to be disclosed. Higher judge, judiciary particularly.
Uploaded on the website.
Uploaded on the website.
We had Justice Kannan doing it for the, he did CO Moto at that point of time when he joined here.
One of the objections for such a disclosure was, look, somebody comes to know from this website that I have 25 lakhs cash in my bank account. And he comes and asks, give me 5 lakhs loan for education of my son. He is no doubt an acquaintance of mine, but I don't want to give. I cannot give the false reason. I don't have that much money. That reason I cannot give. Therefore, it interferes with my private life. That was the defense was put forth in a personal discussion with me by one of the judges. Then I had no answer. Therefore, there is always two angles with the disclosure. One is protection of your life, which includes privacy. Because except with certain amount of privacy, life will be miserable. At the same time, we owe a duty to public, being a public servant, of disclosure. Therefore, these returns when we file, generally, they are not to be disclosed to any third party, except when allegation of disproportionate assets comes. At that time, it can be made over to the investigating agency. Now, income tax returns. They also fall within the same, within this category of the privileged information.
This in fact, that is where that safeguard under Section 8J, exemptions from the disclosures.
From disclosures.
Where it cannot be disclosed, where it is a private.
Only thing is, there must be public interest involved in it.
Yes. And I was just examining, I was just trying to see that Supreme Court judgment on maintenance, wherein it had issued the various guidelines. In fact, they also tell the woman should also disclose their assets. So, qua that, now the, no, after that November 2020 judgment, the things have quite changed.
Inter parties, it will have to be disclosed. Otherwise, what happens is, if you don't get under RTI Act, an application can be made to the court. Court may allow it or not allow it. Ultimately, the person who is in possession of that best evidence but declines to produce it, he would suffer the adverse inference with or without disclosure.
Raghu wants to ask, will this position change with the proposed Personal Data Protection Act?
As long as it is proposed act, I do not want to comment on that, because even author of the report, Justice B.N. Sri Krishna, appears to have serious reservations about the draft act. and proposals, proposed act. Any government would not be eager to enact something which is not their immediate need. In these days of snooping on information, power centers are better served without data protection. Therefore, I do not see any possibility of the Data Protection Act coming any soon. When it comes, we will have another webinar after we are studying. Right now,
it is just, according to you, it is just like that Bangalore Water, when they said that change the definition under the Industrial Disputes Act.
Yes. In fact, Mr. V.V. Giri had to resign from the central cabinet. He was a labor minister. And when the central government refused to notify an award, listening to the managements that it will cause huge burden on the management and the enterprises, he resigned, saying that there is no compulsory, there is no requirement of compulsory arbitration. Negotiations between the labor and the managements in the present scenario is never fruitful. Even if adjudicatory awards you are not going to implement, what is this status of labor? With this statement, he resigned. And we know even enactment under the Industrial Disputes Act, Parliament has enacted, the executive has not notified. Therefore, let the law come, let it be notified, let effective date be fixed, then we will discuss.
So I am unmuting a friend of mine, Mr. Sarah. He likes to ask the question himself. He's also himself very learned. He may not come on the video, but he will ask himself.
Yeah, please, please.
Yeah. Mr. Sarah. Otherwise, I can read his question. He says, my question is, what is the effect of change affected in the explanation? Because the interpretation you are drawing don't flow from the definition of undue advantage.
But you take legal remuneration. Legal remuneration is what is permitted. Of course, there the word remuneration is used. Remuneration, if you go by definition of wages in the Industrial Disputes Act, anything quantifiable in terms of money is a wage. Extend that analogy to Prevention of Corruption Act. I am not saying that my interpretation is correct. I am not saying that anything which is not strictly within the definition of remuneration can still be remuneration. Look at the recent judgments of the Supreme Court. For the last 5-10 years, Supreme Court is not tired of saying Prevention of Corruption Action is a social legislation. Objective of 1988 Act is to make provisions to tackle the menace of corruption more effectively. These two sentences, you will find in almost every alternate judgment of the Supreme Court on Prevention of Corruption Act. In this judicially expansive setting, strictly if you go by the wording of 2018 amendments, even reporting may not be necessary, because now what the now it is defined, a person shall be presumed to have intentional that you work with. If you go by the explanation 2, the expression known sources of income means income received from any lawful sources. Any lawful sources means anything received contrary to conduct rules. Could it be said to be a lawful source? That question is bound to come up before the courts one day or the other. Maybe it will take another 2 years that for it to come up, because if a charge sheet, if investigation is taken up in the year 2018, normally I expect charge sheets to be filed, except in respect of a select cases, by 2022. This issue will definitely come. What I said may not flow from the definition clause, that is undue advantage, but it would definitely flow from explanation 2 under subsection B of section 13(1). And one thing you also remember this phrase, public servant unable to explain satisfactorily. Explain satisfactorily means what? Satisfaction has to be based on common sense, not our erudite thinking. What is the common sense approach? Whether you have reported, if you have not reported, why you did not report? These questions will definitely arise when you are interpreting the phrase satisfactorily explain. In that, explanation will come and the changed definitions of undue advantage also will come. Now suppose undue advantage. Suppose I show the value of my house as having purchased from one person for say 1 crore or 2 crores. And the estimated value of the property is about even 2.5 crores. Then it will still come within the definition of undue advantage to the extent of the difference. And such differences will add up to make your explanation not satisfactory. I'm not saying that this one clause will change, but cumulative changes that have been brought about. My emphasis is only on this. Don't go by omission of the explanation under section 13(1)(e), which said known sources of income means this which you have disclosed. And disclosure need not be to the employer under the conduct rules. Disclosure to the tax authorities under the tax laws, it can also be a disclosure, because there you have to state with your income tax returns the valuation of the property from an approved valuer, approved by the CPWD and income tax department. Therefore, this cumulatively will give rise to holding that our explanation is not satisfactory. That is what I am afraid of. I hope and I wish, as an advocate for public servants, I wish your friend is right. I also pray that I am wrong, but we are in a very unsettled situation. Courts are yet to interpret that.
Mr. Saraf further gives his input. He says lawful source means a legitimate income. So mere omission in the reporting does not change the source.
Reporting, it will enable you to claim legitimacy. I am not saying, now suppose I have declared 1 crore income every year and paid tax on that, say my wife's income or whatever. It doesn't mean that 1 crore income is legitimate. If you look from the income tax angle, income tax authorities are only concerned about declaration of income and tax paid on that. Sources of income, they may not go into. But my emphasis is, even for you to raise that defense, Reporting is the first requirement. Reporting, if you have done, then you can take the next layer of defense, that is about the legitimacy. And remember, the satisfactory explanation that is put on the civil servant under 13(1)(b) or 13(1)(e) is one of preponderance of probabilities, because it is a reverse burden thrown on the accused. Criminal law presumes that crime should be proved by the prosecution. But there are some exceptional circumstances, like this disproportionate assets case, where the reverse burden is put on the public servant. To meet, to discharge that reverse burden, reporting will help. I am not saying reporting will clinch. If there is no defense, no reporting, next stage of defense will not arise at all. That's what the Supreme Court said, that the prosecution is discharged from its obligation to investigate into known sources of income, because 88 Act has said this is the known source which is required to be reported. I'm not saying, particularly in these matters where the provision is new and it is yet to be tested, it is difficult to say what is going to be the interpretation. It is only loud thinking as a law practitioner in the absence of any precedent.
This is one he wants to ask. Dayanand Sagar says it is an excellent session. GD Nadav says whether the managing committee members of the cooperative societies would come under the PC Act.
Yeah, they come under the Prevention of Corruption Act. In fact, the specific clause is there under the definition of the public servant. There is a specific clause which says that the section 2C, if you see, if you go to that, it defines public servant means. Any person who is the president, secretary, or other office bearer of a registered cooperative society engaged in agriculture, industry, trade, or banking, receiving or having received any financial aid from the state government or central government. Now, insofar as the aid is concerned, it need not be a substantive aid. The latest view of the Supreme Court is, this is the phrase used, any sprinkling of aid will make the office bearer of a cooperative society a public servant. And recently I saw judgment of a single judge of our High Court. He said that since the land has been allotted on lease by the state government, Bangalore Turf Club is a public authority under Right to Information Act. Therefore, irrespective of the extent of aid, if there is a sprinkling of aid, and aid is a very a word of wide meaning that depends on the one's view on what is aid, which is not always uniform. Therefore, if somebody can say that, let us say now housing, it can be brought into the definition of public duty over a period of time. Right now, there is no judge-made law which has held housing as a public duty. But my apprehension is that days are not far off when, if housing is recognized as a fundamental right under Article 21, right to living, one day during our lifetimes, we will find that housing would be held to be a public function, providing housing. If that is little expanded, it will become right now. If there is no aid, it is not a, he is not a public servant. But with the use of the phrase sprinkling of aid, that is how the court has interpreted, days are not far off that when it may be either expanded or constricted. Maybe tomorrow three judges will say that aid means it must be substantial. See, for example, in interpreting the word state under Article 12, Supreme Court has held aid should be substantial. Mere maintenance grant is not aid. It also said that it should be of such a nature that control is with the government. Effective control is with the government. All those things have been said. And when it came to Prevention of Corruption Act, the very same Supreme Court said, sprinkle of aid is enough. Earlier, there was a regime when whoever is a public servant under Section 21 of the IPC was a public servant for Prevention of Corruption Act also. Now, the definitions within the PC Act have been enlarged so hugely. Supreme Court said recently that Section 21 of the IP is irrelevant to decide whether a person is a public servant under Prevention of Corruption. Look, from one extreme, we are slowly moving to the other extreme. Whether we have reached the other extreme end or still we are in the journey, time alone will tell. As on today, I can say that if your society has not received any aid, the office bearer is not a public servant.
A few questions we have got on sanction. We will take a separate session of qua that. Because sanction itself is a...
Sanction is luckily not the subject matter for today. Sanction, if you take... Now with the change of definition, whether employed by the government or not, recently, this came in the trustee of educational trust when he is held to be a public servant. This question was raised. There is no authority to remove. Whose permission you will take? Sanction you will take? Then it is not necessary to have a removing authority. But no conclusive finding has been given on that. Anyway, as Mr. Vikas rightly said, sanction is a separate matter.
Yeah.
For which one session?
Few people have also asked, what are your takes, how to remove the corruption? But again, it's not part of the discussion. And few questions we are not taking because we generally wind up the webinar in an hour and 1.5 hours. But it's always a pleasure hearing you. You never know how the time actually prevails because you actually learn during that webinar. It's always a pleasure hearing you.
Thank you.
And as I said rightly. And before we part for today, thank you to all those participants who have logged in this webinar, coupled with who are watching us live on the Facebook, Instagram, and the YouTube. Thank you for encouraging us to bring good speakers like Mr. P.S. Rajagopal, who come and share their knowledge. And tomorrow's topic would be again an interesting facet of law, those who are connected with the arbitration, because this is a debate which is continuing. The seat versus the venue. It is by Ajay Thomas, an independent arbitrator and member of the ICC Commission on Arbitration and ADR. And he had also been a director on the Manav Rachna University school in Faridabad. So do log in tomorrow at 4:30. And thank you, sir, for giving your insight. It was a pleasure hearing to you. And thank you to all the participants and the questions whom we could not take. As they say, sometimes the time also flows. And you have to, when Mr. Rajagopal was... wary of the fact that he took 2 minutes beyond. And we have already touched 5 minutes extra. So
that I don't mind.
No, I say that it's 1:30. The normal cap is 1:30. So I believe that all the lawyers either want to go away with the family, though it's the COVID-19.
Yeah, definitely.
So different. And some want to log in for their office also, because the knowledge which they have learned from you, if they don't apply it practically, it is as good as saying that what we study in physics, that a worker was standing with the bricks on his head, but he didn't move. He said, "What is the work done?" He said, "The work done is zero, because work is worked at the distance travel. That since the distance travel was zero, so anything multiplied was zero is zero." So we don't want that the knowledge shared by you is not actually utilized by them. Thank you for all the participants. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.